That first night at the residential school, I had nightmares. And in the nightmares, I saw this face of this nun. And I was nightmares all through the night, woke up in the morning, I had wet my bed. All the other kids had already gone up and gotten dressed, and she came out and saw me still sleeping and realized that I had wet my bed, had dragged me out, and laid her first beating on me. You get into the lineups, they get you in, cut the bulk of the hair off. After they put you through the delousing or whatever they call it, you're in for showers, scrubbed down into another lineup for your clothes. And most of the kids couldn't speak English. You know, this was their first day run. I would say that the bulk of us were just scared shitless. No parents, no relatives. You weren't allowed to talk amongst themselves. She wasn't selected because she was good-natured and friendly, and they were looking for people who would do the job. Within a few months or a few weeks, she could take a kid who spoke Dene or Gwich'in or Inuvialuit, and they'd stop and start learning a whole new method. And myself and a couple of cousins were holdouts for several years. From the age of 7 through 10, I could basically do basic reading and writing, but I'm also thinking both in English and in Inuvialuit. I could think and talk in both languages. By the age of 10, I think that I must have gotten tired of the beating, because that's about the time when I had stopped. I couldn't carry a full conversation with my cousins. Mainly by that point, my cousins would tell me to shut up. They'd get beaten up as well. In Grolier Hall, during the years of the operation and a few years afterwards, they found that there was some upwards of up to 60 individuals who had died as a direct result of their attendance, either through murder, suicide, alcohol poisoning. That's a pretty high percentage.
to the Federal Day School in Igloolik, because we're still living out on the land. I think that really embedded in my mind that ananamaki nanga surlo powerless, no voice, and she doesn't know where to turn to say, why are you taking my daughter away? She's only six. Like, she's, you know, she just lost her baby teeth. You know, she's only six. Why are you doing this? So I think from that moment, it really instilled in me that, you know, there was something going on. But, you know, when you're 6 years old, you don't understand any of these things. So from that on, from that time, it started to become clearer later on as you grew up that there were just rapid changes going on in our lives, in our communities, and everywhere in the Arctic. And
I lived much like my parents, very traditional Inuit lifestyle. Always dressed in caribou clothing in the wintertime and switched to the store-bought clothing in the spring and summertime. I grew up as a seal hunter as well as a carver and trapper. They took all of our traditional clothing, and for the first time I saw and wore shoes. For the first time I saw a pair of jeans. For the first time I saw a short sleeve shirt, and that's what we were wearing. We had overnight become white men and white women, little children. A grade nun teacher told me to open my hand, and she took a yardstick and really hit me so hard that I can still feel the pain today, you know. And she said, don't ever let me hear you speak that language again in this classroom. You're here to learn to speak and write English and add arithmetic. Forget about your culture, forget about your language, and forget about your Inuit spirituality. My generation of Inuit went through quite a lot. We were sexually abused. We were physically abused. We were mentally abused. Over the course of many years, I got into drinking to hide the kind of shame that I was put through by the church members, particularly a gray nun at the residential school. This is the person that had authority. She had a cross. Crucifix of Jesus Christ in one hand. She represented God. She represented the Roman Catholic Church. So she had a lot of authority. What can you do? Who can you go and tell? Even if you were to complain about things that were happening to somebody in Chesterfield Inlet, nobody would have believed us anyway. Our parents had a great deal of difficult time. They lost their children. They lost their child that they were bringing up to believe that he was going to grow like a true Inuk with abilities to hunt, ability to speak, ability to know the land, the environment that I walk on. But they missed out on that. They no longer know anything about me after I had been to a residential school. We don't hold grudges against those people, but we want to make sure that these things never happen to young people again. Little children, never again, never.
And we've learned that former Catholic priest Eric Dieger has been released from prison. According to a parole board document, it was a statutory release, which means he's completed two-thirds of his sentence and is eligible to complete the last third outside of prison, while still under supervision from probation officials. Dieger has to return to a halfway house every night. Other conditions include following a treatment plan, no volunteer or paid work around anyone 18 years of age or younger, and no contact with children or victims, and reporting any relationships to his probation officer. In 2015, after a long trial here in Iqaluit, Dieger was convicted of 24 counts of sexual abuse that happened between 1978 and 1982 in the Nunavut community of Igloolik. The victims, all Inuit youth in that community that Dieger had access to in his role as a parish priest. Back in 1990, Dieger was also convicted of sex crimes against Inuit youth from his time in Baker Lake, Nunavut. He was released in 1992, and when these new accusations came to light in 1995, he fled to Belgium to stay with his religious order, the Missionary Oblates of Mary Immaculate. Now, he was deported back to Canada in 2011, met by the RCMP at the airport, and was sent to Nunavut, where he spent 4 years in pre-trial detention. That history of fleeing Canada came up in the parole board's decision. According to the documents, Dieger wanted to stay with members of the Oblate Order upon his release. The parole board said no, opting to place Dieger in a supervised halfway house. The Oblates did not immediately return our phone call asking if they are continuing to support Dieger. In total, Dieger has been convicted of sex crimes against 35 Inuit youth, most of whom were between the ages of 9 and 13 at the time of the crime.